for a future intervention targeted at our children, children of African and Caribbean origin. So if you are on, as always, wherever you are joining or tuning in from, please do send in your questions, you know, during the discussions or at the end of the session, or drop it in the chat and we'll pick on those questions. After the first 1 hour, please stay on if you can, and let's do the 30 minutes physical activity as well. So on this note, I'd like to call on our guest speaker today, Lena, to lead today's discussion by sharing her findings on, I'll leave the topic for her to tell us. Yeah, Lena. Thank you. You're muted.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So, hello everyone. My name is Lena Acolatse. I'm a third year PhD researcher based at the Ulster University in Northern Ireland. And today I'll be speaking on parental portion size strategies in the home environment. So, according to the World Health Organization, childhood obesity is predicted to rise to 200 million by 2030. So, by the year 2030, there'll be 200 million more children who are either classified as being overweight or obese all over the world. In the UK, there are 3 in 10 children that are either classified as being overweight or obese. And overweight or obesity in children is especially important for us because obese or overweight children tend to grow up to become overweight or obese adults. And obesity in childhood or in adulthood are associated with certain morbidity risk, such as an increased risk of type 2 diabetes, early onset cardiovascular diseases, sleep apnea, and some cancers. So it's especially concerning when our children are already being classified as being either overweight or obese. So why are we seeing such a huge trend towards overweight or obesity in our children? And the first of these factors is an exposure to an obesogenic environment, which the FAO has described as an environment that encourages sedentary behavior and the consumption of high energy dense food products. There's also, unfortunately, limited information on appropriate portion sizes for children. In addition to this, there's also the portion size effect where, and this is not just applicable to children, it applies to adults as well, where we eat more because we've been given more. So if you have been served a larger portion of food, you will do your best to eat a larger portion of that food that's in front of you. There's also simply the fact that our children are consuming bigger portions of high energy dense and nutrient poor foods. So now we are relatively certain that barring ill health or genetic factors, weight gain occurs as a result of increased food and energy intake. So the obesity and overweight we see in our children is an outcome effect of certain factors. And one of these factors is the increasing food portion sizes. Our food portion sizes have increased over time. And it's not just for the children, but for us adults too. And these increasing portion sizes of food is one of the factors that have been implicated in the rising prevalence of childhood obesity globally. One approach that has been considered to mitigate this is to understand how food patterns develop in childhood. And parents play a key role in the development of child food habits. For many children, the home environment is the first place they learn about food. And research has shown that the home environment has a positive influence on child food consumption. With a larger consumption of fruits and vegetables in the home as compared to other contexts, especially out of home. There are many ways children learn, but for the purposes of this presentation, I'll focus on two main ways. Observation, where children pay attention to what you do, and modeling, where children will essentially mimic your behavior. Parents play a key role in the formation of child food habits, and ultimately, children's food preferences are a sum total of what has become familiar to them. For many of us seated here or watching us from wherever you are, we can identify at least one food behavior we have in common with a parent or even a grandparent. There's that one thing you do that your mom also does when it comes to food, that even maybe your grandmother does. So it's been passed on from one generation to the other. And you'll probably end up passing that same food behavior to your child. Which brings us to the main question for today. How do parents decide on child food portion sizes? So research has found that parental portion size decisions for their children are largely based on their own portion sizes, with many parents using their own food portion size as a guide to serving out a portion size for their children. Experimental data from the US and the UK have shown that there are significant positive correlations between the amount of food parents serve themselves and the amount they serve their children, whether it was a main meal or a snack. This suggests that irrespective of the type of meal it was, if a parent tended to serve themselves a larger portion size of food, then there was a very high likelihood that they would serve their children larger portions of food as well. In the same way, if a parent was likely to serve himself or herself a smaller portion size of food, then they would do the same for their children. In addition to this, there were parents who felt that the portions that they served their children or the decisions with respect to child food portion size were largely intuitive. So they couldn't actually give the reasons why they gave the portion size they did. They just knew what to do or how much to give to the child. There were also other parents who had no basis for their child food portion size decisions. And there was also a group of parents that said that their decisions were based off previous experience with feeding their child. So after years of feeding the child a certain amount of food, they knew that if they were serving a dish of rice and peas, for example, this child would have one cup and that would be enough for them. So their prior experience with feeding that child was one factor that helped them decide how much to give to the child. Parental decisions are also influenced by certain factors. And the first of these is the child's age and size. For many parents, if they felt that their child was small for their age, then there was a higher likelihood to be influenced by this fact. So they will tend to try to serve their child larger portions of food just so that their child could grow bigger. And the opposite was true as well. If parents felt that their child was gaining too much weight quickly, then they would try to decrease the portion sizes of food they gave their child in an effort to try to get their children to lose weight. Other factors included the child's temperament. If a mother or a parent felt that their child was a fussy eater, this tended to influence their decisions regarding the portion size that they offered to the child. The portion size normally consumed by the child was also a factor many parents took into consideration when deciding on a portion size for their child. In addition to having prior knowledge of the child's appetite and how much of a food portion was generally or usually enough for that child. Also, parental knowledge of a child's preferences also influenced their portion size decision. So if a mother made a dish which was known to be well-liked by the child, then the parent was likely to serve that child a larger portion size of that dish as compared to a dish which they knew their child did not like. In addition to the child's own characteristics, there were other contextual factors which parents took into account when deciding on a portion size for the child. The location, for example, where parents found themselves, whether in or out of home, factored into the type of food, first of all, and the portion size that was offered to the child. Additionally, the time of day, whether it was right before bedtime or midday, also influenced how much of a food portion was given to the child. Parents also factored in the timing of the next eating occasion or proximity to the last eating occasion when taking decisions about their child's portion size, as a child may be offered a smaller portion of a food if a main meal was to be served soon. Additionally, research has shown that the day of the week influenced parental portion size decisions, with larger portions of food being offered on weekends compared to weekdays, suggesting that even if parents had a strict regimen for portion sizes during the week, when it came to weekends, they were more relaxed about the portions that they offered to their children. Parents also considered the activities planned for the day for the child. If a child was expected to have a more physically taxing day, then the parents were likely to serve larger portion sizes and vice versa. Other factors that parents took into account included the parents' own childhood experiences with food. Was very important for many parents as they took this into consideration when feeding their children. Parents were also quite wary of passing on their own negative childhood mealtime experiences to their children, especially for parents who were in their own childhood told to clean up their plates before they could leave the table and other such negative mealtime experiences. For some parents, they didn't want to pass on those experiences to their children. And there were also other parents who were unknowingly passing on that same behavior to their children. So in some families, children couldn't leave the dining table until they had completed the meal or until they had eaten everything on their plate. And these were examples of negative mealtime experiences that some parents were wary of passing on to their children. Parents also considered how healthful a food was and tried to serve larger portions of healthful foods compared to foods they thought were unhealthy. The social circle in which a parent found themselves also influenced their portion size decisions, with other parents and even other children influencing parental portion size decisions for their own child. Parents also took into account advice received from a health worker and their own classification of their child as a good or picky eater, with good eaters tending to receive larger portion sizes compared to children classified as picky eaters. So what are the barriers that exist to providing appropriate food portion size for children? The first of these barriers that I'll talk about is a lack of knowledge and awareness of portion size guidance. There were parents who simply didn't know that any such guidance existed. There were parents who felt that their children could self-regulate their own appetite, so there was no need to moderate how much of a portion size was given to their child. And there were parents who really couldn't be bothered about portion sizes at this point in time. Other family members were also considered a possible barrier, especially in instances where their decisions differed significantly from that of the main caregiver. Research from the US has shown that for many mothers, they thought that their partners were possible barriers as they were more likely to bring in high energy dense foods into the home and feed their children larger portions of said foods. Grandparents were also thought of as possible barriers, especially as parents felt that the way their own parents were strict with them when they were growing up, when it came to their grandchildren, they were more relaxed, were more likely to give their grandchildren more treats and sweets and biscuits, and allow them more autonomy when it came to treats than they themselves would have allowed their children. Eating out of home was also thought of as a big barrier because parents felt that once they were out of home, it was very difficult to control the portion sizes that was offered to the child. A parent's own classification of the child as a picky or a good eater was also thought of as a barrier, as this influenced their portion size decisions with respect to the said child. So if a child was thought to be picky, a parent was very grateful, even if they ate something small off the plate of food. A parent's own upbringing was also thought of as a possible barrier because parents recognized that they may be transferring their own negative mealtime experiences to their children. And there were a sect of parents that were very conscious of this and were taking steps to try not to make this happen, while other parents also didn't notice this at all. Additionally, there was the money and time cost of food waste that parents felt if, no matter how healthful the food was, if they knew that their children would not consume this food, then there was no way that they were going to first off spend money buying all the vegetables and then spend a lot of time prepping it to make it delicious enough for the child to eat, and then end up with the child not eating it at all, and they'll probably have to toss it or eat it themselves. So most parents were unwilling to do this. Yeah, just getting a repeat of barriers now. So what are the strategies used by parents for child food portion size? The first I'll talk about is modeling portion size behaviors. It's important because children will model parental behavior. So if you as a parent eat foods in appropriate portion, your children are more likely to do the same. If you eat larger portion sizes of food, first off, you are teaching them that that is okay to do, that's the norm. They are imitating you and will end up doing the exact same things you do. The second is to involve your children in meal preparation, in meal planning, give them small tasks to perform during meal prep. And research has found that children who are involved in meal preparation and are involved in taking decisions regarding the meal and the portion size offered are more likely to consume the portion size that has been given to them, especially for children that are considered fuzzy eaters. Another strategy is to buy prepackaged and child-sized portions. This, in a way, helps you as a parent to set boundaries to how much of a food product your child can eat, so that she can adopt when that 25-gram packet of crisp is gone, It's gone. There's no more to be had. And that's enough for the child. Another strategy that parents have used is to use child-sized utensils. And this serves as a guide to you, the parent, so that when you are portioning out food for your child, you are taking the right amount that's sufficient for them. Research has shown that when you use adult-sized cutlery and utensils for children, you tend to serve larger portions of food onto those plates. And once you serve larger portions of food, you are inadvertently telling your child that this is okay to eat. And like I said before, there's something known as a portion size effect. Once you are presented with a larger portion, you have a tendency to eat the larger portion that has been presented to you. It's also important to start with small portions. And this is a strategy that several parents have used and the research has shown works. You first serve a small portion to your child. And if after they've eaten that small portion, they still feel like there's a lot of space in their tummy, then they can have more if they want it. So it's not as though you are forcing your child to eat more than they want or need at that point in time. You are giving them the option to choose. Also, another strategy that parents have used is allowing their child a certain level of autonomy when it comes to their food portion size. So give them some control over how much to put on the plate. Guide them to serve a small portion first, serve what they can reasonably eat. And if that's not enough, they can still have some more. So for many parents, research has shown that instead of giving full autonomy, they provide some level of guided autonomy to the child. So that if the child is serving a little too much, they are able to say, maybe that's enough. Try eating this first. And if you're not satisfied, you can have some more. It's also important as parents to listen to your children during meals so that when they tell you they are full, you don't force them to eat some more or to clean their plate or to have a little bit more. So this strategy has worked and the research has shown that it works. Help your child to be able to identify when they are full. Allow them to eat only as little or as much as they are able at any point in time during the meal. This is not to say that treats are bad or sweets are bad, but it's important to be mindful of the portions that you offer to your child. And if possible, mix in some fruits and vegetables if you can or if they are available. Setting boundaries has also been a strategy that many parents have used. And evidence suggests that it works most of the time. As a parent, you can set limits on how much of a food, especially when it comes to treats, that a child can have at any one time. Replacement and reduction have been shown to work in a UK cohort of mothers. However, children are really smart. And what we found is that replacement works as a better strategy than reduction because the children are able to tell that the portion of the treat has been reduced. However, when you replace it, then whatever it was you are replacing it with is no longer available. So they don't have an option. They have to eat what you gave them. If at all possible, if you have other children, you can split treat among them so that instead of one child getting a big slice of the pie, it can be split across all the children so that each of them gets a little portion of the food product. So if there's anything you remember from my talk today, I want you to remember this, that getting your child to eat right starts with you. Your child will look at what you do and imitate whatever you do. So thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions you may have.
Thank you so much, Lena. Thank you so much for sharing the research evidence on how we can support our children to eat healthier, not just focusing on portion sizes, but just how to eat healthier. I think I have someone's hand up already, so we'll take some questions. And I also have a couple that I want to ask. Are you able to unmute yourself, please?
Hi.
Yes, hello. Yeah.
Yeah. Dr. Abra and Lena, thank you so much. That was very insightful. But then Lena said something and I wanted clarification. You know, when she was talking about when your kids are eating and then you feel that maybe the petting has had enough. You know, sometimes with time, you're able to know that maybe this food is enough. And then the child still wants more. It's just like you, an adult, where you're eating something. And it's not that you are still hungry, but you just have the urge to eat more. So is it okay at that point to tell the person that, no, I think you have had enough?
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah, I get the question.
So that the person does not have, the bad experiences, and the person also grew up saying that, oh, when I was young, even when I wanted more, my mom used to say no. And so now for my child, whatever my child wants, it's just that I want to clarify. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that question. And this is the practicality of this field of research. You do all the research, but when you go into homes, there are real issues. So in a case like what you've just described, what we would advise is, if you can take away the main meal and offer something else that is not as calorie dense, the child doesn't feel as though you've taken everything away. It's almost like trying out a replacement strategy. So take away that main meal, offer something else so that you are taken to give, if that makes sense.
Yes. Thank you. Okay.
But I believe that is when you, the parent, feel like that what you have provided should be enough, right? It should make the child full. So in that case, you provide something healthier, some carrot sticks or something to make him or her fuller if he still says he's not full. Okay, thank you. Do we have any more questions? If not, Lena, I have a question myself. You mentioned guidance for portion sizes that a lot of people didn't know about. Do we have like guidance somewhere that people can just Google and find for their children? Is there anything like that published?
There are a few. So there's First Steps for 1 to 4 years.
Mm.
There's a gap for older children from 5 to about 12. There's a gap. There's not much available.
Right.
However, Safe Food has a very good resource for portion sizes for children. And it even has examples of food to give, even though most of their examples are not tailored towards our meals and the kind of foods we eat, but you can sort of estimate based off those ones. There's also the Caroline Walker Trust that also has quite a good resource for portion sizes for children.
Right. Yeah, someone is asking, did you say Safe Foods? I'm looking for the references
Food.
Safe as in S-A-F-E, food.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, okay. And then first steps. Yeah, yes. I think I've
and
seen
the
that
Caroline
one.
Walker Trust.
Caroline Walker. Can we have it in the chat, please? People yes, want it in the chat. If you could kindly just write them in there for us, we will be grateful. Yes, I realize we don't have a lot of resources tailored to our community. Like you said, those ones will be there, but it's generic. And that's the kind of work we are trying to do to try and, you know, look at the evidence and tailor it to our community. There's actually been a request for us to do a similar intervention that we had recently for mothers to be able to support their children. And when we do get there, we would call upon you to come in. Help us with all the evidence or the research you are doing in this area. I'll call you the child portion size expert now. So yes, we'll call upon you when we are ready to do that. Do we have any more questions, please? We have a lot of time for discussions. Any issues, you know, that people are facing with having to feed their child? Another thing I found really interesting is when you said the influence of family members. That is really practical to me. So I try not to give, you know, I try to moderate the portions, but my husband on the other side, if he has to do the feeding and I look at it, I'm like, gosh, this is for a child. So all the time, his portions, and so he's like, but she might not be full. And I'm like, oh, she's going to be full. You know, so that is really true. It happens in a lot of homes. And then that grandparent effect, all grandparents just want to spoil their grandchildren, you know, but then they didn't do it with us. But when it comes to grandchildren.
Exactly. It was quite interesting to see that in the literature, like parents are actually saying, my parents did not do this with me, but they are happy to do it with my child. So there's some qualitative work where parents are quoted as saying their parents say that a grandparent's role is to spoil the child. Mm-hmm. And when the parent takes them home, they straighten them out again until the next time the grandparent gets them. So
interesting.
I think we have a hand up.
Okay. Yes, please. Can you unmute yourself? We have Aminat. Can you unmute yourself, please? Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you so much for this session. Even though I came in late, I missed quite a lot. That's fine. But my question is regarding the eating habits of our kids. I have a baby who is just 13 months old, and she eats a lot. Like, she eats, adult food. She eats anything you offer her, she eats. So I'm just a bit worried that is that okay? Is that fine? Because even when I feel she's filled up, she still wants to eat more. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So what we know now is that children are able to self-regulate their appetite. We are just not sure at what exact age that gets turned off. But it turning off is because of the environment that the child is in and what parents are doing to sort of turn that switch off. If your child at 13 months is always hungry, barring any illness or any genetic issues, it's not a bad thing. So far as they are not eating large portions of food at any one time, it's not a bad thing. Your child is still growing, still forming their key structures and such. So if you are very worried about it, then please talk to your doctor
GP?
Or your childcare.
And then they will,
They'll point you out to the right resource.
Yeah.
But my feeling about it is that children are growing, children are able to self-regulate their appetite. So My first thought is don't worry about it, but I can see you are worried. So talk to your GP.
Thank you, Lena. Yes, and then when you go, you know, they might put you in touch with a dietitian and they will do all these assessments to find out other stuff, you know, how active is your child, you know. So, yeah, if you're really, really worried, just please speak to your GP and then they would refer you to a dietitian. Yeah, I mean that. Thank you so much. Do I see another hand there? Toiba, or is that the old? Right.
No, yes. It's a new one. So okay. I'm asking another, a similar question, but differently. You know, so with kids who are fuzzy with eating, you give the person a cup of tea and, you know, maybe, you know, some things more, and the person says, mommy, I'm full, but then you know the person is not full. It goes back to that point where you are trying as much as possible to let a child eat, but then you don't want the person to also think, okay, I'm forcing you to eat your food. Because if you don't force a child in a way that the child is not going to eat that food, then you know that the person has less of food. So in a situation like that, how do you handle it?
So I have a question for you.
Yes.
How do you know your child is not full?
Okay, so let's say we wake up breakfast, right? We haven't had any meal. And then, for instance, I fry maybe one egg and then, you know, a piece of bread and milo. And then the child takes maybe the bread and egg and says, okay, I'm full. I don't want that. I feel maybe he doesn't want the milo. So he says that I'm full. I don't want to eat. But you know, this child on other days will take that same quantity of milo and that same quantity of bread and egg. So it's something that you have done over a period. And you know that, okay, so even with, I wouldn't say portions, but there's not like it's a cup full of milo. You know the quantity he takes. And then there are particular days you tell you, I am full. And you're like, oh, you know, eat it. You know, you cajole the person and then the person takes it. So that's what I'm trying to say. So in situations like that, you don't want it to look like you are kind of forcing him. But then, you know, if you say one or two things, the person will finish that same meal. He was like, oh, I think I am full. So that is where the confusion is.
So my first thought, like, I was listening to you and I just cast my mind back to a conversation I had with my niece yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
So I called home and the first thing I heard was, she has not eaten anything today, yada, yada, yada. And then I found myself mm-hmm. doing exactly what you described.
Exactly.
Why haven't you eaten? What did you eat today? Mm-hmm. Like that kind of thing. It was instinctive.
Yeah.
And this is me who has done all this research and knows that if a child says they are okay, leave them. When they are hungry, they'll come back and say, I'm hungry. This is me, the child nutrition expert, mm-hmm. doing the exact same thing to my niece, you see?
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
it's more how we've been conditioned.
Mm-hmm.
than anything else. So you as a mom, you have to try to actively decondition yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Even though you know that if you cajole your child, they will take it. It's better to listen when he or she says,
mm-hmm.
I'm okay. It may be that just for this period in time, mm-hmm. I don't want the milo and it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
If 2 hours later, he comes and says, mommy, I'm hungry. Then mm-hmm. you know that at this point in time, he's actually hungry.
Okay.
And he will eat whatever it is that you give him. So it's important for us to give them the space to be able to say to you that mm-hmm. this is enough for me at this point in time.
Mm.
I don't want more than this.
Okay.
Even though you know that every morning this child drinks milo,
mm-hmm.
if today he tells you, mommy, today I don't want the milo, mm-hmm. don't push it.
Okay.
It's okay. And when we keep trying to cajole them to do all of this stuff, we are in a way helping them to switch off their internal mechanisms for satiety and fullness.
Okay.
So even though internally he knows that if I eat the milo And if I eat the bread and egg, my tummy will be full enough. Mm-hmm. Mommy says I should have the Milo too. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now mommy has become the environmental factor.
Okay.
That is helping him to stop listening to his internal cue that says stop.
You're full.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll try. The African mother's in us.
Exactly. I totally understand where you're coming from. Totally.
We'll try. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that explanation, Lena. When that question came, I thought about my own experience. So when I was breastfeeding my daughter, my mom was around, and a lot of mothers face that. You know, the only good thing is that I did a bit of breastfeeding counseling myself when I was in Ghana. So my mom would tell me, your daughter is not full. And then I would argue and I'm like, ma, she's full. You know, a lot of the times I'm like, how do you know she's not full? And then she'll be arguing that I have experience and I'm telling you that she's not full. But what a lot of mothers don't realize is that when an infant is born, you know, for the first few days, sometimes they can just take like few teaspoons of breast milk and they are okay. You know, like the first day, second day, third day, people complain that there isn't enough breast milk coming. And so they introduce the infant formula. And then, you know, research will tell you that just a few drops, especially if it's a colostrum, is enough. You don't really have to introduce anything. But we worry as parents. We tend to think that the children and the babies are not full. And then we have to introduce. I remember her telling me that she's thirsty as well. She wasn't 3 months. And I didn't want to, I wanted to do exclusive breastfeeding. And she was saying, look at this child. This child is thirsty. I mean, children under 6 months, the evidence shows us that we don't have to give them water.
Yeah,
that's what the current evidence is showing. Breast milk is enough, you know, but sometimes, yeah, we just worry. And I like the fact that, Lena, you mentioned that even though you are the supposed child expert, you found yourself doing the exact same thing that you are telling us not to do.
Like, you realize the conditioning is inside, like it's it's so deep in that you have to always be on top of yourself, like be conscious, else you end up doing those exact same things to your kids as well.
Yeah, and that's why we have these sessions, you know. It's just a way to remind us, you know. And I like that this you've looked at a wide range of research, and unless you don't believe in research that cuts across so many parents, and this is what they are telling us that works. So let us just remind ourselves of these things we are learning today, so that once we are in that routine thing we do, we can just, you know, cut ourselves to remind ourselves that, okay, this is what I've learned and this is what the research says, so maybe I should do it the other way. Now, to add on to what you were telling Toy about, unless you have concerns that your child is really underweight or losing weight, then you need to speak to your healthcare provider. You know, there are instances where we have fussy children who might really not eat and be losing weight, where a lot of the times mothers can tell. And if that's the case, then please do speak to your healthcare provider, and then you would be referred to a dietitian. As much as we talk about these public health issues, another thing I keep emphasizing is that nutrition needs to be individualized. Okay, so sometimes this generic information, yes, it's for public consumption, but there might be some peculiar cases where, you know, the advice must be tailored to that family, to that mother, or to that child. So if you do really have concerns, then please do speak to your GP, let them refer you to a dietitian or a nutritionist, and then you'll be given, you know, that tailored care your child needs. Okay. Lena, did you come across anything on fussy eaters? Like, what's the research saying about, you know, children who are extreme fussy eaters?
Yeah. Did you see anything like that? When you say extreme, what do you mean?
Extreme. Like, they won't eat anything.
So there's a very interesting paper by Claire Holly, where she She did a randomized controlled trial with fussy eaters, and she used four different intervention or four different arms. There was one where a child was allowed some level of autonomy, one where the child was given rewards, one where the reward was sort of verbal. So the first reward is something the child can actually see and feel and touch. The second reward branch was words. Mom says, oh, good job, well done, that sort of thing. And then the fourth was giving the child autonomy plus rewards. And then the fifth was no treatment. It turns out that for children that are considered fussy eaters, they work well, or they are better when you give some level of autonomy plus a reward. But it's important that the reward is not a food-based reward, because these are children that are already having issues with food. So say if you allow them some level of choice in what to eat and how much to eat, and if they are allowed, when you're meal prepping, they are allowed to be involved. They see what goes into making the meal. They have a chance to say, I want this much or this little. Then they are more likely to eat what they choose. And then if afterwards you give a gold star for eating, it improves their behavior. So the next time they are more likely to eat, because they know, first off, they have a chance at input. Their decision is not just mom or dad. They have a say in the decision-making process. And two, after they eat, there's a reward.
That's really interesting. You know, it's just when you were talking about this, I thought about the different, you know, so for teachers, you realize that there are different kinds of learners, and sometimes we box all people, yeah. You know, sometimes we say these people are not smart and these people are smart only because some people pick things really fast. So we have people, that's how I thought about this. So, you know, inferring from that, you're just trying to say children react to things differently. So, you know, if you just change the way you go about it, you realize that they might not necessarily be fussy eaters. You just have to learn how
what makes them tick, what right. makes them accepting, you know. And it's interesting, just when you were talking, I remembered something else. This is not exactly research based, it's just
anecdotal.
Mm-hmm. You know, when you have two children who are very different when it comes to their food behaviors. Maybe your firstborn was very accepting, very, like, they would eat anything you put in front of them. Then you have your second child and they are this, everything you tried with your firstborn that worked does not work with your secondborn. And mom goes, this child is so fussy, they don't eat. But it's just a matter of, mom has not learned what works for this child. And interestingly, most mothers don't even realize that these are two totally different people. So what worked for child one may not necessarily work for child two. And just, you know, sometimes when you just think about the effort it will take you to and learn all those strategies, to come and learn new ones for this child, it's just overwhelming. So you will try to keep pushing with the strategies you know are not working, you know? So it's just something we constantly need to be aware of, that each of your children is different. And what works for child A might not work for child B. Some women are lucky. All their children are the same. Like, what they did for A has worked for B, has worked for C. But for some, A is a whole new ball game. B is totally different. And C is in a class of their own. So,
so you know, when you were talking about it, I was just thinking about my own household. And, you know, I'm like, what time do I have to now unlearn what I did with my first child? It's really not easy. But then again, I just have to remind myself, because it's something I constantly say, that healthy eating needs to be deliberate. It is not easy, even for adults. You know, you need to make a conscious effort as an adult to be able to have a healthy dietary behavior or lifestyle. So in the same way, I think it's an investment if we want to have healthy dietary behaviors for our children. I'm not saying it's going to be easy, because as I sat here, I was just rolling my eyes. I'm like, because I know some mothers who say they have to sing and dance and do all sorts of things before they get their children to eat, you know. So ordinarily, those children might be seen as fussy eaters, but when they do those things for them, then the children eat. But if you are like me, who is always busy, then you might just end up saying, oh, my child is a fussy eater, because you will not get a time to do those things. But yeah. It is good that we are being reminded about these things or what the evidence is saying.
So when I don't know if the hand up is a hand up from
an old one. Let's see. There seems to be. Is that a new hand up?
No, it's an old one. Let me.
It's an old one. Okay. Yeah, it's confusing. I was just finally going to comment on when you talk about the rewards, and then was it a rewards, you know, when you give your children autonomy. So there was a session that I had here a couple of weeks ago. So we got some mothers to just share practices, healthy practices that, you know, they're undertaking in their home so other people could learn. And one of the mothers said for a very long time, her children won't eat fruits. So she decided, you know, she thought of a new strategy, and then decided that every time she's going for shopping, she has three children, she'll get them to choose the fruits. And she told them, you have the option of choosing two fruits. So each of them would choose. And then condition was that once you have chosen it, you have to eat it. And she said she was just, you know, amazed as to how this suddenly changed them, you know. So everyone chose. So a lot of us just buy one, two or three. Two fruits, oranges is just oranges, or, you know, bananas. But then the kids started choosing a variety of fruits. And then it turned out that, you know, they actually liked fruits. They just were not getting the ones that
they
liked.
Wanted, you know.
They wanted a variety. But then we just assumed, okay, oranges are nice. And then we just buy oranges. And so, yeah, we need to be innovative and deliberate if we want our children to eat healthier. Right, we don't have a lot of time, so I'll just give you the opportunity to say your last words, and then can bring the session to an end. Yeah.
Yeah. So I just want all of you to go with this in mind, that you have to put in the work on behalf of your child. You are the gatekeeper, so to speak, to them learning about healthy meals, to them forming healthy food habits, to them knowing what the right amount of food is. So as a parent, if you do all the wrong things, then your child is likely to also do all the wrong things. But if as a parent you do mostly the right things, then your child imitates your behavior and ends up doing mostly the right things. So a huge part of the responsibility lies with us as parents to guide our children towards doing the right things for their health. Yeah. So thank you all for listening.
Thank you so much, Lena. Now, my final words. You started with some alarming statistics, you know, and the projections show that if we continue on this trajectory, the next generation, we will not have healthy people at all. You know, now we say 2 in 3, next generation will just be everybody would have one chronic disease or the other. So just to re-echo what she said, the onus lies on us. We live in an obesogenic environment. The environment promotes unhealthy eating. Look at the portion size effect. You go to buy food, the food portions are huge, and we are forced to consume everything. We go and unhealthy foods are on promotion. So yeah. Buy one, get one free. We have a huge responsibility to try to not let the environment influence. I know it's easier said than done, but hey, we don't have a choice. We don't want to have a future generation where our kids cannot function. No, that's not what we want. So please, let's try our best and protect our children. Another reminder is that dietary behaviors are harder to change as adults. So let's put in all the efforts to ensure that our kids adopt healthier behaviors right from the onset. That would be one of the biggest investments we could make for our children. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining this nutrition session. Next week, we have another researcher coming to talk about the nutrient contents of African and Caribbean foods. You don't want to miss it, so please join. However, I am going to end now and hand it over to Orlando for our usual physical activity session. So please do stay on, engage in the physical activity session. Thank you so much, and I hope to see you all next week. Thank you, Lena. Thank you so much.
It's my video.
Yes, Orlando. Lena, do you want to stop sharing your screen, please?
Hey, there we go. Hey, Dr. Yeah. Hilbert.
Hey, Orlando, nice to see you.
Hey, good evening, everybody.
Let me take the spot.
Yes.
Side of myself. Yeah. And
there we go. Hey, everybody. Good evening and welcome to the fitness aspect of today's session. Thank you, Lena, for that amazing seminar. And thank you, Dr. Haber, for facilitating that for me. Are you able just to put me on spotlight? Because I can't see anything.
Let's see. I thought I had done it. I think you are on spotlight. If someone could just confirm that. Are you?
No, I can just see you. Yeah, there we go. There we are.
Yeah.
Full HD now. All right, guys. So welcome to today's session. As promised, we are going into circuit training. But as I explained last week, we're going to split it up into different groups of body muscles, okay? So we're going to go upper body, lower body, and core. So tonight, we're going to start with upper body. So all the exercises are going to hit the muscles of the upper body. It will be a little bit of crossover, so we will hit a little bit of core and a little bit of legs. But that's just exercise for you, okay? So today's session, you'll need a mat, some weights or a kettlebell. I'm gonna use some tin cans of food for a couple of the exercises. And I have my kettlebell as well, which I'm gonna use for an exercise or two. So if you have anything like that lying around the house, then quickly go and grab it, as well as your mat or your cushion or whatever you use, or if you're hardcore, just on the hard floor, it's up to you. All right, so as we do, let's start tonight's circuit session with a warm-up. So if you're ready, find a space for me, and we're just going to start off nice and simple with a jog on the spot. Okay, let me just turn these tunes up. All right, people, let's get sweaty now. It's game time. All right, find your spaces. Let's jog. 3, 2, 1, go. That's it, people. Get that knees up a little higher now. Oh. 10 seconds. Three, two, one. Okay, legs are back. Ankle touches. And go. That's it, people. Tap those ankles. Do 10 seconds. Back into that warm-up. So we're gonna start off again now with squat reach. So squat down nice and deep, touch the floor, pop up, touch the ceiling. Let's go. 3, 2, 1, up. Really stretch the shoulders, stretch the back. That's it, people, keep that going. 3, 2, 1, straight into star jumps, to the front. Keep that going, people. Should be feeling nice and warm now. You might have broke a sweat. Side lunges. Let's go. Keep that going, people. 10 seconds. Game time. Quick break. Alright, people, last few sips of water. Alright. So, like I said, we've got an upper body session, okay? So we're gonna hit all the body parts of the upper body, all the muscles involved. Try and get as much done as we can. So we've got two rounds coming your way. 4 exercises per round. And for each move, we'll go at 60 seconds at an intermediate pace, mixed in with 15 seconds of rest, complete rest. All right, so first 2 moves coming your way. If you've got your weights on your cans, you can bring them forward. We're hitting the shoulders, all right, the whole shoulder. This is called the Arnold press. So start off, palms facing you, cans together or hands together, depending on what you're using. And from there, we're going to go around and up. Okay, you see the cans? And then reverse the move coming back. All right, so nice solid legs. Keep that core nice and upright. Slight bend in the hips, hands together, push around, come back, push around, come back. From there, you can use your cans again. We've got bent over rows, so double-handed bent over rows. Okay, so bending the hips here, slight bend in the knees, arms start straight, and then pulling those elbows into the ribs, nice and strong. All right, try and bring those shoulder blades together as you pull. So bring those shoulder blades together there, bang. Boom. Okay, I'm gonna use my kettlebell for that one. So again, I've got the kettlebell here, slight bend here, bend there. I'm bringing those shoulder blades together, like so. All right, so we've got Arnold press, 60 seconds and rest. And then we've got bent over rows, 60 seconds and rest. First two moves, people, let's get busy now, come on. So get to your spaces. Start off. Three, two, one, go. Nice and strong. Awesome, going around, press, squeeze those shoulders at the top. Working them shoulders. Arnold press, come on. Keep that going, people, keep that going. 20 seconds left, keep that going. Going there. Up, squeeze, down, back around, keep going. Last 10. Five, four, three, two, one, and rest, my people. Well done. One down, three to go. Quick rest. Five seconds, get ready. Two, one, let's go, roll, let's go. Nice and strong. Elbows nice and close to the ribs. That's it, people. Keep that going. Okay, nice and strong. Let's go. That's halfway. Keep it going. Let me show you the beat. Keep that going, people. 10 seconds. Four, three, two, one. Rest. Well done. Two down. Well done. Quick rest. Okay, you can put your weights aside and bring your mats in. Let me go through the next two moves real quick. So first one on the knees. Okay, we got press-ups going forward. So we miss angle. So hips, shoulders go down at the same time. So you go down, as you come up, bang, shoulder tap. Down again, alternate, shoulder tap. Down, shoulder tap. Okay, from there, we've got push-up to plank without the push-up. So watch me here. Knees up if you can. And we're here. One, two, three, four. Down again. One, two, three, four. Let's get busy now, come on. So start off on your knees. Press up to shoulder tap. You ready? Three, two, one, go. Press-ups are balanced. Body weight's going down at the same time. Keep that going, people. Halfway. Keep it going. Five, last one of this round. Press up to five. Get ready. Three, two, one. Go, let's go. Finish yourself. That's it. Come on. Work it, people. That's halfway. Keep that going. Come on. Water break, 30 seconds. Seconds, my people. I'm gonna go into round number two. Okay, listen in, people. We're going into round two now. All right, so first two moves, we're gonna hit upper back, the traps, and the biceps. All right, so we've got upright rows. Let me get my kettlebell in. So again, you can use your cans of beans, your weights. I'm gonna use my kettlebell. So watch me here. Nice strong base, and I'm pulling the kettlebell up my body like that. Okay, elbows will end at the side, flared out. Watch again. Nice and strong. Up here. Get to the bottom of the chin, hold, squeeze. Watch from this side. Upright rows. Pull, squeeze. Watch from the back. Pull up, squeeze right at the chin. All right, from there, again, with your weights, we're hitting the side of the shoulders. So we've got lat raises. So we're here, and bang, raising right to the side, nice and strong. Come back nice and slow, bang. Down nice and slow. Boom. Okay, let's build those winter bodies now. All right, so from upright rows, again, you can use these for upright rows. So you can be here. Same drill, same mechanics. Or you can use a kettlebell, it's up to you. All right, from there, lat raises. All right, let's go. First two moves. Let's turn this up. Let's get busy now. We'll start with the upright rows. Let's go. Get ready. Three, two, one. Let's go, rows. Let's go. Squeeze. Nice and strong, people. That's it, people. Don't have any equipment. Say move. Oh, nice and strong. Try and replicate that weight. That's it. Keep it going. 15 seconds left. Last 10. Four, three, two, one. Quick rest, my people. Quick rest. Ten seconds. We're going to go into lots more raises. Get ready. Three, two, four, let's go. That's it, people. Get a nice squeeze at the top.
Just giggle yourself really control and the power that be
moving. That descent.
No one is like one. This is a toy that should be the life. Let's tune into the man with the most and find who is that man. No one.
Keep that going, people.
Halfway.
Let's go. Keep racing. Come on. Let's go, last 10. Let's go. Five, four, three, two, one. Time, people. Well done. Two down. Two to go. Rest period. Okay, listening while you rest. Next two moves. We're going to hit the triceps now. All right, so first move is tricep kickbacks. And we're going to work one side at a time. So watch me. I've got my can again. So bending the knees, bending the hips. Here's your starting position right there. From there, just extend the arm and squeeze. Okay, so we're working this side here, this part there. So in, out, squeeze that tricep. Nice and strong. Back in, squeeze. Okay, we've got 30 seconds there, and then we'll change for 30 seconds. So here, start either side, it's up to you. There, and squeeze. From there, we've got reverse flies. We're working the mid-back, upper back. So both hands here. Starting bent over, and we're gonna bang, bring those shoulder blades together, nice and strong. So watch again. There, nice and strong. First flies from this angle. Oh, bring those shoulder blades together. Elbows out. Bam. All right. So tricep kickbacks to reverse flies. Last two moves, people. Let's get ready now. Let's get ready. Back to your spaces. Nice. Last 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time, people, well done. Two rounds down. All right, 30 second water break, and then we'll cool down and stretch off. Well done, people. People, join me back in the middle. All right, let's cool down and stretch off. Okay, so first move we're going to do is called Toy Soldiers. All right, so we're going to kick out, kick the leg out, touch it with the opposite hand. Let's go. Okay, now let's go next side to side. Ear to shoulder. Let's go. And around. Okay, hip circles. Change direction. Front to back. Feet together, try and touch your toes. Up, nice and slow. Shake it all off. That's time, people. Well done. Well done. Do we have Daniel on the call? Elizabeth?
Hi, Orlando. Thank you so much for that session. It was amazing. It was amazing. Let us know in the chat how you found that session. It would be great to hear from you. Did you feel energized? Did you feel challenged today? It would be great to hear from you guys. But yeah, thank you so much, Orlando. What can we expect next week?
So like I said, we're going to split the body parts into three. So we're going to go from upper body movements like we did today to next week, we're going to go lower body movements. So it's all about the legs, the glutes, the calves, okay? And then from there, we're going to focus on the core. So that'll be the third week, and then we'll cycle through again, different movements.
Nice, nice, nice. Thanks again so much for that, Orlando. And next week as well, we will be back with Healthy Heart, and our topic will be nutrient intake of African and Caribbean adults in the United Kingdom. So tell a friend to tell a friend, invite people. It'll be great to have more people on the call for next week. And also we have our Saturday program, which is Health Hour, which will take place from 11 a.m. to 12:15 p.m. on Saturday. So that will be our Health Hour. So yeah, we'll see you either Saturday or next week for Healthy Hearts. Thank you so much and take care and have a great night.
Well done, everybody. Have a great week. Peace.